Thanks, everybody. Thanks for having me. So today I'll be talking about corruption, organized crime, and indigenization in the Nigerian oil sector. There we go. So the motivation here is that we have a substantial body of evidence from the multinational investment literature, which basically tells us that multinational firms are typically more productive than local firms. Now, this evidence basically comes exclusively from the manufacturing and service sectors of countries that are relatively politically stable. In contrast, it may be the case that in markets that are characterized by corruption, conflict, or political instability, that multinational firms may not be well equipped to deal with the types of challenges that this kind of political economy context will present. In contrast, local firms might possess the connections, the knowledge, the kind of legal flexibility to navigate these types of political economy constraints. So the question that I'm gonna address in this paper is essentially, what is the trade-off between these two forces? The kind of technological human capital efficiency advantage of a multinational firm relative to these kind of intangible comparative advantages of localness. So I'm gonna study this question in the context of the Nigerian oil sector, which is kind of a great test case for a context in which multinationals may indeed face, really kind of extreme political economy circumstances. In particular, a sector characterized by corruption, theft of resources, militant violence, and kind of rebel activity. And so what I'm gonna do is estimate the effect of divestment of multinational assets on the productivity of oil fields using a wave of divestments that has occurred in the past 20 years in this market. And so what we're going to look at is basically the difference in differences effect of those divestments on productivity. And kind of establishing the main result, which is this kind of local advantage idea, then I'm going to identify the mechanisms of local advantage using a simple bargaining model. So, to preview the results, what I find is that local takeover of an oil field increases productivity, leads to fewer non-producing assets, increases oil spills due to equipment failure. That is, it appears that local firms are actually less technically efficient, but despite that, they achieve greater productivity. Now, that's a little bit of a paradox. The question is, how do they do that? And I find that local firms kind of accomplish this by mitigating those political economy risks. In particular, once those assets are divested, they experience less theft, less violence, and less maritime piracy. And these are the kind of three key criminal risks that these companies face in this market. So let me talk you a little bit through the context. The context is that Nigeria is a major oil exporter, one of the largest in the world, and all of the oil production in the country is concentrated in the southern Niger Delta region. This is a very kind of anarchic, complex political economy situation. There's many armed groups in this region that compete violently over the rents from this natural resource. In particular, from 2000 to 2009, this kind of evolved into an open armed struggle in which organized militant groups waged war against the Nigerian state and the oil companies. Okay, so there were these bombings and kidnappings, which were meant to essentially extract concessions and rents from oil companies. Okay, against this kind of chaotic backdrop is an interesting phenomenon of black markets for crude oil. Okay, so there's a widespread phenomenon of oil theft known as bunkering in the region, which occurs when these criminal groups and militant groups essentially install taps on active pipelines to siphon the crude oil to their kind of nearby boats. And they either sell it on the local market or they sell it to nearby oil tankers for export. This is not a small, criminal activity. This is by far the most profitable criminal activity in the region. It's worth about $4.5 billion annually. So that amounts to 15% of Nigeria's entire oil output. So this is a massive problem. Nigeria is losing about 15% of its government revenue, since its government revenue is almost exclusively oil. you know, the reason this emerges is because of the kind of geography of the pipeline network. So you have thousands of miles of unsecured pipeline, which kind of crisscrosses these militant held territories. And what naturally arises are protection rackets. That is, these gangs and militant groups are able to use violence to kind of extort oil companies into bribing them, you know, to buy protection, to leave them alone. And so that interaction is basically what we're going to be studying in this paper. And it's also alleged that politicians and security agents, primarily from the military and police, are kind of intimately involved in this market, providing protection for these gangs in exchange for kickbacks from the oil profits. So here's a kind of simple graph of the trends in the black market over time. The black line gives you the number of monthly spills, oil spills that are related to theft. Whereas the gray line gives you the number of monthly spills that are related to kind of standard operating practice, okay? And as you can see, like the gray line is going down, meaning companies have kind of become more efficient over time. They're spilling less oil, but their losses from this theft problem have been massively increasing over time, particularly after the end of the formal conflict in 2009. So what is indigenization? Indigenization is an important trend in the market that's kind of going on in the background of all of this. In particular, there's this massive wave of divestments to local independent Nigerian firms. So Nigerian firms in 1998 owned about 3% of the oil fields in Nigeria, the producing oil fields in Nigeria. Now that number is up to about 15%. A lot of this has to do with what's called the Local Content Development Act, which is a 2010 law that gives preference to local firms in bidding on oil blocks. Another kind of source of this trend is the conflict and theft problem. That is, in the onshore market, multinationals are very vulnerable to these problems, risks. They're affecting the bottom line. So basically they're selling off assets at a massive rate and they're moving offshore. That allows local Nigerian firms to enter the onshore market. And this is exactly what we see in these two figures. I'm plotting the number of fields and the share of total production by local firms and breaking that out by onshore and offshore market, okay? And what we see is by either measure, there's a substantial increase in the onshore presence of local private firms. They're increasing the number of fields and the total share of production substantially. So they went from basically zero, less than 5% of production on the onshore market to almost 40%. And as you can see, the line indicates that 2010 law, that's really where you see the trend break, right? That local content development law is giving preference to these local firms and acquiring new oil blocks. And that's really driving this wave of divestments that we see in the past two decades. So let's dive into the results since we don't have a lot of time. But like I said, this is gonna be a difference in differences estimation. We're gonna look at those kind of staggered adoption divestments, and the outcome is, at least the first outcome of interest is going to be the productivity of the oil field. So the standard difference in difference is two-way fixed effects regression. On the right-hand side, the main treatment indicator is whether the oil field is owned by a local firm at time T. Okay, of course we have the field and time fixed effects, and a bunch of field level controls that are interacted with the year dummies. In particular, those are kind of like technical features of the oil field, like the number of wells, the production capacity, these types of things, so that we can kind of control for differential trends along those dimensions, which might be correlated with the divestment indicator. Okay, and the outcomes that we're gonna study are gonna be first productivity. So we wanna establish, is there a local advantage? And secondly, all of these kind of things that we think are driving the local advantage, like these criminal activity indicators. So here are the results from that estimation. Panel A gives us the output and efficiency results. Those are basically establishing the local advantage fact. So what do we see there? First two columns give us the results for shut-ins. Shut-ins are defined as non-producing assets. Okay, so that's a dummy variable for a field that is not producing. In the kind of pre-divestment period, you have a lot of multinational fields that are kind of decaying or kind of shut off entirely because of this political economy and the conflict that's going on. They just kind of abandon certain fields entirely because they're, in some cases, not even able to access them with their personnel. What happens when a local firm takes over is that rate goes down substantially. So they're bringing more assets back online. And you know, that extensive margin effect is in part responsible for the next two columns, the results in 3 and 4, which are a massive increase in output. So here that coefficient is measured in millions of barrels per year. So we see that local firms increase output by about 1.7 million barrels per year, which is a 60% increase. We're talking about massive increase in productivity. Granted, it's from a relatively low base, because as I mentioned, you know, the multinationals are not doing particularly well in this market. The last two, so that those two results kind of establish that this local advantage does exist. The next question is, does that come at a cost? So for this, I basically estimate the difference in differences regression with the outcome as the number of operational spills or losses, you know, kind of due to standard practice. So what that means is, you know, a firm that experiences more losses is probably operating less efficiently, basically. And we do find, in fact, that local firms increase losses, although that is not always significant. There's some suggestive evidence that local firms are less technically efficient, as we might expect. So, you know, local firms are increasing output despite being less technically efficient. How can they do that? Well, they're going to do that by reducing the political economy risks. So when we look at panel B, this is the same estimation, but the outcomes are for crime and violence indicators. So the first outcome, probably the most important that we should really be focusing on, is oil theft, right? Because this is the number one risk and source of inefficiency that firms are facing in this region. What we find is a substantial and significant reduction in theft of about 3.5 incidences per year, which is roughly a 30% decrease in theft, which is quite large. And there's kind of a concurrent decrease in violence, which is defined as kind of the number of gang-related violent deaths that occur on or around the property, the oil property, the field. And that's also significant, and that's basically a reduction to zero. So it does seem like local firms are basically able to eliminate the extreme violence that's associated with this kind of gang activity almost completely. And the last two columns give us the effect on maritime piracy, which is another risk that these firms face. And that is when kind of like these gunboats basically go up to oil tankers or oil platforms, typically offshore, and they just basically like run on and like steal oil, kidnap people, things like that. And that's quite a common occurrence in this region. We also see a reduction in that, although it's not significant. So an interesting way to kind of falsify these results and kind of, you know, dig into the chain of causal logic is by looking at the effects by asset type. So the heterogeneity of these effects by onshore versus offshore assets, okay? The logic behind this test is that offshore assets are not really exposed to those political risks. So onshore is where the theft and the kind of militancy and gang violence problem is really concentrated, because it's very hard for these gangs to like go to an offshore platform. Like I said, those maritime piracy acts are much rarer and much more difficult to kind of costly to engage in. So the vast majority of the risk is onshore. If that's the case, we should also expect to see the local advantage showing up onshore, if that's what's driving the kind of increase in production, right? And that's exactly what we find. So, you know, here I have the six outcomes and I have standardized coefficients from those difference and differences regressions for the onshore and offshore subsamples, okay? And what we find consistently is that local advantage shows up onshore, in these gray coefficients. So the reduction in shut-ins, the increase in output, that's almost entirely concentrated onshore. The effects for the offshore market are insignificant, okay? And that kind of matches up exactly with the reduction in theft and violence, which occurs, again, almost exclusively onshore. In contrast, the offshore market kind of has higher technological requirements. So this is a test of the multinational advantage in efficiency, because that's where we would expect that advantage to be greater, because those are, you know, really much more technically complicated activities. It's much easier to extract oil onshore than it is offshore. And we find that that's exactly what happens, that the kind of increase in operational losses, which we see here, malfunctions, is significant and positive for the offshore market, but not for the onshore market. The last piece of evidence that kind of like, you know, fills out this falsification test is the effect on piracy. And that's basically almost exclusively an offshore activity. So we expect to see that showing up offshore as well. And that's basically what we find. The effect on piracy is now significant and actually quite large. If we just look at the offshore fields, the onshore effect is basically zero. Of course, we want to see the event study plots to kind of assess whether pretrends are contaminating the difference in differences. So here's event study plots for four of the key outcomes. This is production, operational losses, sabotage, which is theft, and conflict and death. And you know, you see similar stories for all of them. I would say the most pronounced effects seem clearly to be for the oil production and theft, which is kind of consistent with the pooled two-way fixed effects results, in which those were kind of the most robust and significant. And those are really the ones that are most directly linked to the model that I'm going to show you. So that's actually what we kind of care about most. I have a kind of battery of robustness tests for this using the kind of state-of-the-art two-way fixed effects kind of corrections that have emerged in the past couple of years. And you know, we can kind of skip that for now in the interest of time. So let's kind of dig a little bit into the mechanisms here, right? The question, of course, is what drives local advantage? Why is it that these local firms are so much better at kind of mitigating these political risks and increasing output? Okay, I have 1 minute, so let me massively speed through this, and I'll probably skip the empirical results, just give you an intuition as to why. So, you know, I model this interaction as firms interacting with these gangs and kind of bribing them for protection. And the inefficiency from theft is what creates kind of a window for bargaining. The inefficiency arises from the fact that criminal profits are kind of less than the losses that the firm experiences because gangs incur a cost of stealing oil, and also because there are direct losses, as in when you cut a pipeline, oil kind of spills out into the ground. So these two forces give firms a strong incentive to kind of make a deal. The question is, why do we see oil theft in equilibrium if firms do have these strong incentives and there's this kind of bargaining window? What I find, or kind of what I model, is three different frictions in the bargaining process, all of which could be less severe for local firms, okay? And those frictions are the cost of a bribe, that is kind of dealing with these gangs through intermediaries, which are typically like security agents from the army or police, or the corruption penalty, that is, you know, multinational firms being exposed to home country corruption laws like the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which will fine them if they're caught kind of engaging this type of bad behavior. And lastly, partial ownership. This is a situation with many joint ventures, and if local firms are more likely to have sole risk or kind of like larger equity stakes, then they basically internalize a larger share of the losses, and so incentives are aligned for them to kind of bribe these gangsters, okay? So those three factors may all be more severe, those three frictions, from multinationals, and that's what can drive local advantage, essentially, even despite a technical advantage for multinationals, that is, a lower operating cost for multinationals. So is there evidence on these? I'm not gonna go into too much detail because I'm out of time, basically, but I do find evidence for each of these three mechanisms. I do find evidence that local firms have better political connections, which leads to a reduction in bargaining costs and leads to eventually a reduction in theft. I do find that those home country anti-corruption laws are associated with increases in theft. So countries or companies that are kind of hamstrung by those corruption statutes experience more depredation on their assets. And lastly, I do find that these divestments result in more concentration of ownership among local firms. So local firms are much more likely to have like single stakes, what we call sole risk contracts, and that's I think a kind of driving factor in their ability to internalize the losses from theft. There's a lot of potential alternative explanations, of course, and I go through a few of them, but again, we can skip that for the Q&A. And so in conclusion, I find that local firms are more productive, they're able to achieve this by mitigating their political risk, and those three mechanisms of political connections, corruption penalties, and equity consolidation do seem to be driving this effect. The policy implication, I think, is primarily that in these kind of natural resource sectors, which are characterized by corruption and crime, it may be good to indigenize. That is, divestment is a good thing, and countries should probably be pursuing policies that incentivize multinationals to divest their holdings. So that's all I've got today. Thank you, guys, and I hope I didn't go over too long. Thanks.
Awesome. Thanks, Jonah. No, it looks like we're pretty good on time. I think we probably have time for maybe one question. I'm not seeing any from the attendees, either in Q&A or chat. Do the panelists have maybe one question for Jonah? It looks like we do have one question from Jessica Miranda saying, do you think that another mechanism might be that local firms are more able to lobby for security from the government?
So I mean, that's kind of part and parcel of this political connection story. I should have made this a little bit more explicit, but I didn't have a whole lot of time. What I do find is that local firms are more likely to have connections to the security forces. So it's a slightly different mechanism. It's not direct lobbying. It's kind of like personal networks. And those local firms, and basically those connections to security forces result in a substantial reduction in crime. I don't have data on like police deployments or things to see whether that's being driven by greater provision of like a kind of private public good, or whether it's basically being driven by what my supposition is that like these police are kind of selectively enforcing, and they're going to enforce on assets where they've been paid off basically, and not on assets where they haven't, or kind of assets where they have connections. So, you know, I find in my data that a lot of these local firms have like former inspector of police on their board as a shareholder. And I do find that like those types of connections substantially reduce the amount of theft that they experience.